and welcome everybody to the talk. My name is Dr. Corné Swart from Cellbox Solutions. And in the last few years, we've been pioneering the ways that you can transport cells, specifically more complex and fragile materials, 3D cell cultures, and also more recently integrating into living therapies. In this presentation, I will be taking you through a couple of concepts that focuses on where you start thinking about adding shipping and logistics workflows into your sharing and also into your commercial workflows, and furthermore, talking about a couple of user cases. Right in the beginning, I want to take a look deeper into the future with you and talk about the perspectives that we have for the regenerative medicine market. And the talks that we've had earlier today have been brilliant to set the stage for this. We've heard a lot about the different ways that you can use stem cell therapy and also use more advanced things like tissue engineered products and scaffolds. Right now, it's estimated that approximately 1 in 3 people can benefit from regenerative medicine treatments, just because the conventional methods of treatments cannot yield them as it currently stands. This is, however, quite limited right now. Worldwide, there are approximately 64 approved advanced therapy medicinal products. Of these, 34 are cell therapies, and 10 of them are tissue engineered products. When we look at a closer level to the European landscape, 15 advanced therapy medicinal products are registered, but 4 of them have already been withdrawn. So we can see that there is a really great opportunity to implement new regenerative medicine products, but as has been mentioned in the previous talks as well, there are still quite a few challenges that we have to address. One of the challenges that we here at Cellbox are looking at more closely is how we can solve some of the challenges with distributing complex material. And I'll start off at the hand of using an autologous cell therapy workflow here. When you start off with biological material from a patient, this is then transported usually in the cold chain or in a cryopreserved format to a manufacturing site. At the manufacturing site, the cells are manipulated, expanded, and then also taken into their final format before they are transported in the cold chain again to the hospital, where the patient whose cells were sent away for modification are then returned to them. When you're planning this entire process of shipping and logistics, there are a couple of key concepts that you need to think about. And this starts with the nature of the material. Do you have a single cell-based product? Do you have a co-culture? Do you have something more complex like a scaffold or a bioprinted product? And when you've looked at the features and the characteristics of your product, you also need to consider what are the best ways to preserve this during transport. Is a fresh transport the best way to go? Do you need to do this at physiological temperature? Do you need to take it down to colder temperatures, 4 to 8 degrees Celsius? Or is the best way to get this sent to the final destination a cryopreservation process? When you have the characteristics in mind, another important topic is the packaging, primary and secondary packaging, which fits into the regulations for transporting biological material. When this is defined, it's important to also look at your choice method of shipping, the actual technology that you'll be placing your product in when you ship it worldwide or over the canvas in some cases. There are active solutions, there are passive solutions, and in recent times, we've also been seeing some hybrid models coming into the market. All of these together are also subject to regulatory compliance. When you're transporting your biological product, however it's classified within the regenerative medicine space, there are specific guidelines, such as ISO standards or others, that will dictate what you're allowed to do with these materials in terms of preparation and transport, along with what kind of data is necessary to be collected. Quality control is also an important topic. Will you be doing the quality control at the manufacturing site before you ship the material over to the hospital or the clinic? Or will you be doing the final quality control step at the bedside? Or is the entire process potentially at the bedside? There are different models. And then finally, in the end-to-end chain of custody, it's also important to collect all of the data across the entire workflow, straight from the manufacturing process, all of the data that's coming from the instruments that are being used in the manufacturing process, capturing the patient's data, capturing the transport conditions, and also making sure that the product does not spoil during the transport procedure. This current status quo that we have for transporting biological material is cryopreservation. And cryopreservation is not going to change anytime soon. This is a trusted solution and it's been very effective. And the majority of the established cell therapies that are being used are also dependent on finding a proper cryopreservation procedure. Nonetheless, more questions are being asked about the impact on the cells. What does the freeze-thaw cycle do to the cells? And how does it impact the quality and then eventually the efficacy of the regenerative medicine product that you are delivering? There are other factors to include in this. What is the reculturing and recovery time of the cells? How long and how sensitive is the transport in terms of when does the patient need to receive this material? And then finally, once the cryoprotectants have been introduced into the sample, this also needs to be removed before it can be administered to the patients. Taking a step back from the actual clinical applications and the regenerative medicine, I'd also like to talk a little bit about the 3D cell culture environment and how the fundamental research going into the preclinical and finally into a product can take place. Now, as Johanna mentioned earlier today, in the last 20 years, we've seen a drastic shift in how researchers have been using cells, starting off with immortalized cell lines, which are really simple to maintain, cryopreserve, and ship around. But in recent times, we see fragile iPSC-derived cells or embryonic stem cells that require slightly different conditions. And if you have material that is primary and also comes from patients who are ill, then the quality of the cells are also affected. Then in the next stage, we have organoids, we have spheroids, we have 3D bioprinted material. These are very complex, and depending on the methods and technologies you have available within your laboratories, it becomes quite difficult to cryopreserve them and then transport them where your partners or customers can receive them in a way where they can use them effectively in their projects. At the end of this, one thing that we've been spending a lot of time on is developing near physiological transport conditions. When you have a product which you're maintaining at 37 degrees and 5% CO2 in your laboratory, then in our opinion, it is the best way to also transport that material. Don't change the conditions, because everything that you do to a complex system is definitely going to have an impact on that. And you may not be aware of what the final impact will be when you're looking at omics data that you're generating from the material that you're transporting. Furthermore, when you're doing cryopreservation steps, you also have to take into account that you're losing time during this process, because the actual transport is a stationary phase. When you're transporting under incubation conditions or near physiological conditions, you also have the opportunity to extend either the expansion or maintain the cells in the active state so that once they arrive, they're ready to use. Choosing the correct shipper is essential. There are, as I mentioned on one of my earlier slides, you have passive shippers and you have active shippers, and more recently, these hybrid solutions. And this is something that I feel there's quite a bit of, or a lack of information available to scientists so that they can effectively choose for their type of material what is the best shipper that they can use. In this case, I'll start off with passive shippers. Passive shippers are usually a styrofoam container or a strong outer case, which contains preconditioned phase change material packs. These are preconditioned and they will hold an internal temperature, sometimes for a few days. And they're extremely effective in areas with a low infrastructure. They're very validated, very well validated, and widely used. The only drawback that comes and is quite obvious here is that intervention will not be possible once the package's integrity fails. And the temperature is also not actively regulated. Once the temperature is being defined and set in this phase change material, you will have a passive degradation of the temperature over time. Furthermore, depending on the manufacturer of the phase change material, it may also contain toxic chemicals, which will limit the capacity to be transported across international borders. On the other hand, when you look at active shippers, which are predominantly used in the cold chain industry, they have either a mobile power source or they have an external power source that they're connected to during transport. Historically, they regulate temperatures quite frequently from ultra low temperatures throughout to cold chain temperatures. temperatures. And with new technologies that have been coming to the market, we also see temperatures of ambient to physiological temperatures being possibly configured into these systems. With an active shipper, you can respond to the environment. So if you have a device that's sitting outside on a runway next to an airplane and it's really cold, then you have the option that the heating elements can respond and make sure that the products contained inside are not affected by extreme environmental parameters. The drawback, however, is that these are standardly more expensive than your passive solutions, and that intervention in these cases can be possible when you need to recharge and resupply, and thereby using the proper logistics providers and also doing a risk assessment before your transport, you have the possibility to have a near infinite time for transport. When declaring these kinds of products for transport, you need to keep in mind that they often have lithium ion batteries, which needs to be declared for the transport, as well as dry ice pellets. Our product, the Cellbox, is the first portable CO2 incubator that has an international flight allowance. We have two variants of these boxes, the ground model, which can only be used for ground-based transport, and then our Cellbox flight device, which has been carefully engineered and fulfills all standards and regulations to be transported, not only on a commercial airline, but also a cargo airline. Looking closer at the two technologies that you have for transporting things under incubation conditions is our Cellbox Ground, which is similar to a traditional CO2 incubator. It uses a small CO2 cartridge, liquid-based, which is installed into the system, which then becomes pressurized and is therefore only authorized for ground transport. These cartridges are medical-grade CO2 and provide 5% CO2 environments for more than 72 hours of transport. On the other side, we have the Cellbox Flight CEI model. This is a non-pressurized system to be compliant with airline transport regulations. And as such, we had to re-engineer this to use dry ice pellets and the natural process of sublimation. These dry ice pellets are not used to create a low temperature for the cell transport, but within this thermally insulated container, the dry ice will turn into CO2 via sublimation, which is then pumped into the incubation chamber afterwards. Just a few elements on the device. It's an intelligent system with a touchscreen. Users have the opportunity to set up their own temperature and CO2 parameters. But more importantly, the data is captured during the transport. The system has an integrated SD card, which will collect all of the important parameters during the transport, save that to the SD card, and make it available for export post-transport. On the storage component in the incubation chamber, there's space to transport approximately 4 liters worth of cell cultures. This can be either in the format of multi-wall plates, tea flasks, cell culture bags, or various other formats that we have available for use. Post-transport, we have a Bluetooth connection, and with a Bluetooth connection, you can speak directly to the Cellbox app, which is available on the iOS platform, as well as the Android platform. The data files, which are imported into the app system, they are in a CSV format, so you can choose your own processing tool afterwards to also analyze the data. We will also be releasing a CFR 21 Part 11 compliant model next year to be integrated more closely into our regenerative medicine projects. Now, you may ask, when you're transporting cryopreserved material, this is relatively simple to package and also to maintain during the transport. But when you're shipping cells in a fresh format and you also want to have access to a CO2 supply, you would need an innovative solution to do that. So in this case, we're showing an example of how you can transport in multi-well plate format. This is standardly available in various well formats. The wells are sealed with a CO2 permeable foam that is placed on top of the multi-well plate. Completely liquid tight, it creates a microenvironment where humidity is not lost. This is then placed on top of a absorption material before it's placed into a CO2 permeable safety pouch, which is also CO2 permeable. And these systems can be combined with other cell culture consumables, such as tea flasks or cell culture bags as well. For the entire procedure, once you've packaged your material, you can transfer your material to your stationary incubator within the racks that we also provide along with this device, which can also be used in passive shipping solutions. The device needs to be preconditioned 30 minutes before the transport, and then it's important before the logistics partner takes the box that you've checked the battery status as well as the status of the CO2 source. Once everything is ready, the data logger can be activated and the samples transferred to the box before it's handed over to the logistics partners. The Cellbox is not only a valuable tool for shipping internationally or shipping long distance, we've also worked with a couple of groups to validate it as a over-the-campus transport solution. The data that I'm showing on this slide was generated together with the GAM lab at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, where they were transporting retinal scaffolds across the campus. The study was performed in two steps. The first step being validating the performance and runtime of the Cellbox device, and then the second step, transporting these very fragile retinal scaffolds to the imaging facility. Post-transport, the retinal cell viability was analyzed, and we could see no significant change between those transported across the campus versus those maintained in the Cellbox device. Furthermore, investigation of the fluorescence, which was driven by the cone rod home box, this is an important marker for the retinal development. And we could see that there's also no significant difference in the expression. Morphology-wise, there was also no change in the organoid, in the retinal scaffold structure when investigated with the microscope. Another very interesting project we did together with Poitis, based in France, was looking at the transport of full human thickness skin models. Their product, PoiSkin, is very unique, and they were also a spin-off from the INSERM and the University of Bordeaux. The technology that they have is a laser-assisted bioprinting technology that enables the printing of an 8-layer skin model. This was transported for approximately 7 hours, and post-transport, it was analyzed by histology. The data that was generated from this transport also nicely showed that there was no significant difference in the histology of a full-thickness skin model being transported under incubation conditions versus those maintained in the laboratory. This is a very exciting prospect because this product is also intended to be a tissue engineered product. And then with the final words for wrapping up, I would also like to announce that we have a new packaging solution from Cellbox to make shipping easy for everybody. And with that, what you ship will finally be what you get. These packages are put together with 24, 96, and 384 well multi-well plates that also contain a CO2 permeable seal, all of the labels that you require for shipping, as well as additional cartridges or consumables that are required for operating a Cellbox device. Taking this one step further, and also reflecting on what Johanna mentioned earlier, the study that we did together with Max Planck Institute and Dr. Jan Gruder's group, we had phenomenal results transporting midbrain organoids within a nanofibrillar cellulose. And as such, we will be bringing a new product to the market where you'll be able to transport your organoids or other cell types within a nanofibrillar cellulose manufactured by UPM. And for that, I would like to thank you for taking the time to listen to this, and I welcome questions, and I'm looking forward to the panel discussion.